A 79-year-old man often develops swallowing difficulties and subsequent choking while eating food. Which of the following pairs of muscles is most important in preventing food from entering the larynx and trachea during swallowing? Choking while eating results from incomplete closure of the inlet of the larynx. The inlet of the larynx is guarded by the epiglottis, and it's the epiglottis that moves backwards during swallowing. This is assisted by elevation of the larynx as a whole, resulting in closure of the inlet, thus preventing food from entering the larynx and trachea during swallowing. The cricothyroid muscle in the first option is a small muscle, and as its name indicates, it extends from the cricoid cartilage to the thyroid cartilage. When it contracts, it moves the thyroid cartilage forwards, and this results in tension in the vocal folds. So it has nothing to do with the inlet. Vocal folds are located below the inlet of the larynx. Thyrohyoid, again, as its name indicates, it extends between the thyroid cartilage and the hyoid bone, is one of the infrahyoid muscles that depresses the hyoid bone and has nothing to do with the closure of the inlet of the larynx. The second set of muscles, levator villi palatini and tensor villi palatini, these are muscles of the palate. And here you can see this is the levator villi palatini, and the tensor villi palatini will be located to the a little bit lateral to it. And here you can see this is one muscle on one side, the other muscle on the other side. The aponeurosis of the muscle here will create the skeleton of the soft palate and is not related to the larynx. In fact, these muscles, as their name indicates, levator elevates the soft palate and the tenses the soft palate, and they block the oropharynx from the nasopharynx and prevent regurgitation of food from the oropharynx to the nasopharynx, but they have no role in preventing the food from entering the larynx. The other muscle is the cricopharyngeus and trachealis. So cricopharyngeus muscle is the inferior transverse fibers of the inferior constrictor muscle. It acts as a sphincter at the beginning of the esophagus that only opens to allow food or drink to pass, but do not allow the passage of air. So it's a sphincter in the gastrointestinal tract. It has nothing to do with the inlet of the larynx. Trachealis muscle, these are the smooth muscle fibers that are located in the posterior part of the trachea between the two ends of the tracheal rings, the C-shaped tracheal rings. They are controlled by the autonomic nervous system to control the diameter of the trachea. It has nothing to do with preventing food from entering the larynx. They are present in the trachea, which is below the larynx anyway. The other set of muscles is the posterior cricoarytenoid and the transverse arytenoid muscles. The posterior cricoarytenoid muscle, as its name indicates, it extends from the cricoid cartilage. Actually, it's from the lamina of the cricoid cartilage, and it is attached to the muscular process of the arytenoid cartilage. So this is the direction of the pull of the muscle. When the muscle contracts, it results in rotation of the arytenoids, causes abduction of the vocal folds, which are attached to the vocal process of the arytenoid. So it causes abduction of the vocal cords. In fact, it's the only muscle that produces abduction of the vocal cord. The transverse arytenoid muscle is represented by these horizontal muscle fibers that extend between the two arytenoid cartilages, and when it contracts, it causes the adduction or approximation of the arytenoids, resulting in adduction of the vocal folds. So it acts on the rima glottidis. It causes closure of the rima glottidis, but it doesn't cause closure of the inlet of the larynx. This is where the inlet of the larynx is located. So both these muscles, the cricoarytenoid and the transverse arytenoid muscle, they act on the vocal cords and they control the opening of the glottis, the rima glottidis. The other set of muscles, the oblique arytenoid and the aryepiglottic muscle. This is the oblique arytenoid muscle here. This is one muscle. This is the other one from the other side. They are set obliquely behind the arytenoids, but in fact, they are the continuation of the aryepiglottic muscle. So the aryepiglottic muscle, as its name indicates, it extends from the epiglottis to the arytenoid and is located here, just deep to this fold, the aryepiglottic fold. The aryepiglottic fold is located at the border of the inlet of the larynx. It is the superior border of the quadrate membrane. And this aryepiglottic muscle is going to continue as the oblique arytenoids. So the aryepiglottic and oblique arytenoid are in fact one muscle. When these muscle fibers, they contract, they will cause approximation of the arytenoids, as well as they will pull on the epiglottis downwards, and this closes the inlet of the larynx. When the larynx is elevated by the suprahyoid muscles or the extrinsic muscles of the larynx, this will facilitate closure of the inlet of the larynx.